We now bring to you another informative session on ethics in medical education, time for introspection. So to enlighten us on this topic, we would like to invite our chairperson for this session, Dr. Shiv Sareen, Director, Institute of Liver and Biliary Diseases, New Delhi. I request you, sir, to kindly come on to the stage.
Our first panelist for the session is Professor Dr. Bipin Batra, Executive Director, National Board of Examination. I request sir to kindly come on the stage, please.
Now I would request Professor Rita Sood, Head Department of Medicine, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi, to come onto the stage and take her seat.
I would like to welcome Dr. K.K. Agrawal, President, Indian Medical Association, to kindly join other panelists on the stage, please.
I'll request Dr. Girish Tyagi to join in. I'll have to go a little bit early, so he will continue after I leave.
I would like to call Ms. Shobha Mishra Ghosh, Assistant Secretary General, FICCI, New Delhi, to join the panel discussion.
I would like to request Dr. Nilesh Bhai V. Parekh, Professor and Head, Ophthalmology, Government Medical College, Bhavnagar, to kindly join the discussion, please.
Finally, I request Dr. Ashok Kumar Agarwal, Dean IIHMR, New Delhi, and President, Academy of Hospital Administration, to join.
I'm Dr. Nilesh.
Our moderator for the session is AVM Dr. R.K. Rania, VSM Additional DGAFMS HR. I request you to kindly take your seat, sir.
Thank you, sir. Before we begin, I would like to say a few words about the chairperson and keynote speaker for this session, Professor Shiv Kumar Sareen. Sir is the senior professor and head hepatology and director, Institute of Liver and Biliary Sciences, New Delhi. Sir was instrumental in setting up the institute under the aegis of the government of Delhi. Sir is credited with several new treatment protocols for liver diseases, especially variceal bleeding, liver regeneration, etc. He is also the founding co-chief editor of Hepatology International. Sir has won many national and international awards for his untiring efforts. I now request sir to please deliver the keynote address for this session.
Good morning. First of all, I would like to say it's a different feeling of coming here, and I thank Shakti and the group. Also could see how All India Institute has taken this major area and has involved the private sector so well. This is education for me also, that there is ethics in involving everyone. And the way you have done is exemplary. I bring greetings from ILBS. The main issues, as I have been asked to cover, is on medical education. So I'll just try and see. As you know, the word from Greek means habit, action, and character. And each one of them, if you look, are philosophies, but they need to be converted into reality. And when you call of medical ethics, which I am not discussing, is related to medical practice, which is being discussed. What I have been asked is on medical education, where I think more important is knowledge, skills, practice, and finally patient. And this has not been defined. What we defined in 2010 in our vision document for the medical education in India was the following: what should be an Indian medical graduate, IMG? And this should be a clinician, a leader, a communicator, a lifelong learner, and a professional committed to excellence. Now, this has been in the vision document of 2015. Each one of them involves ethics. Clinician means who understands and provides preventive, promotive, curative. Now, if you haven't studied medicine, there is no way that you would understand. There is a word called compassion. He is a leader, so you, all the doctors who pass out must have this quality that they can collect, analyze, synthesize the health data. So when this was written, we were not so sure what ethics would mean for medical education, but the wisdom of about 200 people who worked to define an Indian medical graduate, this required 200 people for 1 year to define what an IMG is. So this, you will see every word has a meaning which goes to education. Communicator, so he is able to communicate the problems of litigation. He is a lifelong learner, so you can't say I don't need medical education anymore. And who himself is ethical and is committed to excellence. Now with this background, let me go further. What medical education means? So this is simply, today you have a curriculum, you have tools, and you have Rita here, who is such an expert in this, who would tell you. But the first idea and the question which you raised is time to introspection. So when we realize that there is a problem in assessing medical colleges, assessing the institutions, the first concept which came, the first question which came in mind is that the raw material should be good. Like you make Maruti, you have OEMs, a good raw material, and then you have the finished product. So the first thing in mind was neat, which is the raw material, and I'll come to it gradually over a period of time. So what are we? You have teachers, you have material, that is the patients, and then you have the environment, which is in your medical college. Now what you want with NEET is, you have collected the raw material, now you want a good student. Let's see how you can do that. So when you take in NEET a good student, you have no fraud in selection, the first process. Then what is left to us in medical colleges, there is no fraud in teaching, and there is no fraud in environment. The raw material is good, but you can spoil the raw material if you do not have these tenets, and I think each one of them would require a separate discussion, and if the medical aims can take these up areas. Then when you have a good student, there is no fraud in the sense knowledge, attitudes, and skills. All these need to be very well collected. Finally, the product. You have the raw material, you have given an environment, and now you have a product. All what medical council does is to see the processes, but the processes do not involve the quality. What I'm showing you here is how do you maintain quality, and at the end you have a national exit exam. It's just not a licentiate exam, it is to make everybody, whether he is from north, south, east, he has the basic tenet that yes, he is a good basic doctor or a specialist. Now at the bottom you see something like a white coat ceremony. I do not know how many of you would remember what is a white coat ceremony. So when this was written several decades, centuries ago, when the doctor wears a white coat, it is that I accept
to do ethical education practice. That is white coat. I'm not saying that the lawyers have black coats, they have something else. I'm not saying that. But what I'm saying is white coat. And this is a rigorous ceremony, and that was envisaged in Vision 2015, that when a doctor comes, when a medical student comes, first 2 weeks, he is trained in ethics, then he gets a white coat. He doesn't get a white coat on day zero, he gets a white coat on day 16th. We have forgotten, and I think we should revisit this. And at the last, when the product is ready, when he passes his MBBS, you have a Hippocratic Oath. We have forgotten, we just have it read out, but I think every part of that. So the raw material and the finished product and what you do in the medical college. Let's go a little further. The problem is, you do not know how to measure quality. But if you cannot measure something, it's not worth knowing. So the most important part, to manage quality, you must measure. So what are our measures and can we create? And it is for that you have an exit exam, which I think is very important for us. So let me summarize this part. A good raw material with no capitation, equality of opportunity to everybody, and a good finished product. Test it anywhere. Take your Maruti Euro 4 level, test it anywhere. Any road, you will say it's good. Indian doctors, which are a brand, test them anywhere. And therefore, I want you, and I hope the Indian Medical Association has a approval of national exit exam. So you have, last year, 6,70,000 appeared for NEET. This year, 12 lakh. It was so heartening. I was following the whole day. Oh, 12 lakh people have appeared. People have an interest in medical profession. We were feeling everyone doesn't want to join. I think we are coming back that people have at least some interest. So assessing the product is my second part. And this is something which we need a statement sometime from our Prime Minister. And the statement should be, if he is wearing a white coat, if the Prime Minister wears a white coat, which I think he wears, is the most ethical person, I would like him to say, if I were you, I would give medical education. First as education, then profession, hope, and its respectful dues. We need to bring back that respect from society back to medical profession. You can call it ethics, you can call it anything, but bring back that ethics. And the ethics is in education. We are clear, each one of you as an ambassador are clear that we take honestly the best people, we train them in the best manner, and we get back the best product in the market. So how do you do it? When I was a student, my teacher would come at 7:59. I used to wait. Any day he comes after 8 o'clock. I failed in 5 years to see that he would be late by 1 minute. We were taught by people like this. Zero errors. So I would like to read this. There is no right way to do a wrong thing. Medical teachers to lead by example. I think that is the basic bottom line for medical education in India, and I would like you to be party to this. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shesharin. All my panelists as well as the people in the audience will agree that he has given us a good platform to start our discussion on ethics in medical education. Now, since he has left, how exactly the Indian medical graduate should come up, the brand name which was told in the previous panel discussion that we are having a good brand name even abroad. I will start with Dr. Rita Sood. Ma'am, nowadays what is seen that there is a craze of doing the post-graduation? Now the question is, people start from the final year of their MBBS. Sir, after this, sir, I will just start and give it to you, sir. And rather concentrating in their internship to acquire the clinical skills or the acumen, they are just preparing for their NEET PG, ma'am. May I request to throw some light if there is any restructuring of internship curriculum, ma'am?
Can I pull it closer to? Thank you for having me here. Now, as Dr. Sareen has already mentioned, you know, the challenges that we face. The medical curriculum is very rich on biomedical sciences. But when we come to talking about so-called soft skills, which is behavior, ethics, is something which is, all of us know, is not too strong, but because it's not assessed, like Dr. Sareen mentioned. What you don't measure doesn't get done. So when they come as interns, as you mentioned, you know, what is the issue? They're busy preparing for PG entrance examination. But when they come as interns, you know, if they may be busy in doing PG entrance examination, which is largely knowledge-based, MCQ-based. But then how do we measure what they do during internship? Now, internship is a period when we expect that they would learn the practical skills and they would learn the art of doctoring. But when it comes to measuring it, giving assessments, we fail. No, even today, even just last week, I had one intern's assessment being marked by a resident and then countersigned by one of our colleagues, which says all A's. And then, now, we, however best one may be, you know, I don't think anybody will measure up to all A's, particularly when it comes to, we all know that, you know, when it comes to punctuality, documentation, all that we are supposed to learn during internship. So this is again where we fail as teachers to really give them a good feedback on what they should be doing and what is expected of them. They may have different agendas, but then we know what is the outcome expected at the end of internship. Now, another thing is, so when they're preparing, they really don't know what to expect from internship. So one of the things which is actually should be done and something which we have an experience with is doing an internship orientation program. You know, as Dr. Sareen mentioned about the Vision 2015, it suggests that we need, as students, they come as raw material. They need an orientation. They need a foundation, which is, you know, when they come, enter, when they enter into clinicals, and internship is one period, when they enter into clinicals as so-called budding doctors. So we had this internship orientation program where when we planned this few years ago, and one of the things we were asked was, what will you do in this? And one of the things that we mentioned was, teach them about professional and ethical behavior. One of the things besides communication, art of documentation, how to rationally ask for investigation, how to rationally, you know, approach a patient and behavioral issues, communication being one of the important establishing a doctor-patient relationship. The question was, what will you teach in that? Which means we ourselves have little, you know, issues about defining what this ethics and professional behavior curriculum would be. But something which actually can be done. So what we did was, you know, have and this is not, ethics is not something you can teach standing behind a podium. This is something which we have to get them involved. So what we had was interactive lectures, small group discussion, using a lot of ethical dilemmas that we would often face as clinicians, and having them role played, which helps them internalize those issues. So an internship oriented, and to us, this was a very, very good feedback. Besides many other sessions, ethics and behavioral, professional and ethical behavior was one of the sessions that we did as an internship orientation program. And this was received very well. And then we followed up during the internship, the same batch of students. And this is not something which you can administer as a capsule. This is something which has to be shown in everyday's behavior as, I think, role modeling, you know, showing them what we do rather than what we say is something that they listen to. So I think, and ethics one is something showing them and not just telling them is something which is needed, which is the key, particularly when they come as interns, when they are really in the wards. Second is, when we talk of ethics teaching, it is not a capsule. It is something which has to be interwoven throughout their course, throughout their internship. And basically, I think three things, three C's, like previous session, which have to be kept in mind is that it has to be clinical, it has to be contextual, and it has to be case-based. We cannot teach ethics in a vacuum. We cannot teach ethics without clinical context. So I think these were the things that probably during, throughout their internship, if they are not only told, but they are shown how to, you know, how to conduct, how to have those behaviors which we expect from them, and also have some kind of assessment at the end of, you know, postings when they go through it, is something which can have an impact. Thank you.
So what Dr. Rita Sood wants it, it's not only the students who are to be taught, it's the teachers themselves should be well aware of these ethics before they can be a role model for the interns. I will break a bit of a sequence and jump onto the clinical practice Sir,
just to answer further, the Vision 2015 document divides the NEET exam into NEET 1 and NEET 2. So NEET 1 is theory and NEET 2 is post internship skill assessment, and 50 marks are for each. So partly the the skill learning would become part of it.
We will just jump the queue and go on to the various institutions and on to our medical fraternity practices. So may I request Dr. K.K. Agarwal, sir, it is being observed that various medical institutes are indulging in publicity, sir, for the state of our equipment they have procured, their devices, their expert procedures, and even the education qualification of the consultants they are having. Is it ethically correct, sir? And how much a government should allow in this scenario, sir? May I have your views, sir?
Thank you for the mic. First of all, greetings from Indian Medical Association. We today are 300,000 doctors spread over 30 state branches and 1,700 branches. And as I have to go and my job will be done by Dr. Girish Tyagi once I leave, I'll pick up couple of questions. First, I'll just say what is the exact question, and then I'd like to put some questions to Dr. Shiv Sareen on behalf of Indian Medical Association. Now, regarding publicity, there was a time when we were medical students, we were taught that you need to learn only evidence-based medicine, and you need to be scientifically correct. Then a time came that we said, no, you need to be ethically correct. Unfortunately, when I got my degree, I was not made to sign any ethical MCI declaration. So, but the time came that you need to be ethically correct. And now, because of the cases we are talking about, you need to be morally correct also. And now the last thing is, every day we are talking about with criminalization of medical practice, you need to be legally correct also. So these, unfortunately, scientific medicine is being taught to us in medical science. We were not taught what is moral medicine, we were not taught what is ethical medicine, and we were not taught what is legal medicine. And today, all the new laws are talking about going to jail. And if you see the West Bengal Clinical Act, it is, you shall be imprisonment for up to 3 years for violation of any clinical practice norms. To that level, we have gone to understand the legality of the whole thing. Regarding publicity, there are, in Medical Council of India rules, if you see the ethics regulation, 6.1 and 7.12, you'll find a disparity. In 6.1, it clearly says that you shall not do anything which attracts patients. So if you solicit any patients, it's illegal. But in 7.12, it talks about that the institutions owned or run by medical doctors can do 1, 2, 3, 4 without publicizing your photograph and other things, but they have said this is what you can do. So there is always, depending upon when you want to advertise, if it is a first practice, if you are changing practice, if you are going on holiday, you can do practice. But printing your photographs in different sections is not allowed. And at Medical Council of India, we did, when I was a part of the Medical Council Ethics Committee, we did call a couple of hospitals who were advertising with photographs of the doctors, and they had to withdraw their ads from the newspapers with that. So one line is very clear, soliciting patients. Whichever law it is, the word is soliciting patient. Anything which solicits patient, which indirectly means that you are soliciting patient, whether, say, nowadays if you see, forget about 6.1 and 7.12, talk about Just Dial. If you ring up, you just call up Just Dial and you ask him, I want the phone number of Dr. K.K. Agarwal. So they will give you the phone number of Dr. K.K. Agarwal, but they will also write down, by the way, there are three more doctors practicing in that area if you may like to contact them. That's absolutely illegal. That's absolutely unethical. You are soliciting patients. And those doctors who are doing that, who are giving their consent to do that, that amounts to unethical practice. And that happens every day. You go to Practo, you go to any electronic media and a digital media, and if you ask for a query, they will give you six more alternatives. And in those six more alternatives, we doctors are involved. That's something, as an illegal practice, we must come out of that. Now, IMA is concerned about medical education. The concept is medical education. I slightly want to differ on the topic.
Dr. Agarwal, may I? No, sir. You're going to now ask questions to him.
Yes,
sir.
I'm
asking. One question to you, sir. Whatsoever you just
no,
said.
No, what
sir.
I'm trying to say is
no, ask. Sir, you have just seen the previous panel discussion, sir. In this, they spoke of a facilitator for the medical tourism. Is it a facilitator or is it marketing strategy, sir? I just want to comment on that.
See, marketing strategy, very clearly, 1.9, touts cannot, in Medical Council of India ethics regulation, it is very clear, touts cannot be involved. Unfortunately, medical profession, which are corporate houses, are run by a businessman, not the professionals. A businessman is the one where a degree is not required. But for a medical professional, you require. So medical doctors cannot solicit patients. Hospitals are soliciting patients through marketing agents, through their marketing department. But if they are doing it for the doctors can be caught. So doctors, directly or indirectly, cannot get a patient through marketing services. That's my view.
Thank you, sir.
And I just want to add, one is on the next. My request to you, being in the committee of the core committee of the Medical Council of India, is what IMA wants is a common final exam. We are against next. We are against one more exam to the medical students. Why can't we have a common final examination? Find out a strategy. We will support. To one more exam after final examination, we are opposing it. So that's our request, and we wanted to get our view. And the third thing which I want to say is, when you talk about medical education, equally important for Medical Council of India is, because today 7 lakh doctors are in practice. If you are going to improve medical education today, the results are going to come after 5 years. Are we waiting for 5 years for the patient-doctor relationship to improve? So we need to come out with something for the general practitioners. Whatever ethics we are talking about in medical education, make a program which we can propagate it to the medical profession right today. Quick response will come from the practitioners, not from the future students. Future students are required for a long-term strategy, but we need to have both immediate and long-term strategy for that. And last, there is some changes which public expects. We did a survey of ALERT, A-L-E-R-T, A for acknowledge, L for listen to the patient, E for detailed explanation, R for review, and T for thank you. 90% public wants, I should introduce, not only I should acknowledge the patient, I should also introduce myself. I'm Dr. K.K. Agarwal, Mr. Shiv Sarin, how are you? L for, in the first sitting, I must give a maximum listening, not the second sitting. We normally have a habit of investigating on the first sitting and explaining on the second. But they say, no, explain to us in the first, we may not come to you on the second time. And E for explain about everything, and the R for review, 90% people wants to ask them what they have understood. And you will be surprised that 60% today wants that I should thank the patient. They thank you for giving me an opportunity. So there is a paradigm shift in the thinking of the people that needs to be added not only to the medical students, but also to the medical practitioners. And I will now like to leave. All my answers will be taken over by Dr. Girish Tyagi.
The first one, first I must admit that you are ahead of time.
Thank you.
What you have done, I must publicly say, is exemplary. About the plan for the next exam, or the NEET PG, was saying that at the final year there should be a national exam, but the problems were
the states,
and they were not willing. So what we said is, there is no other way. If that happens, then it is the ideal scenario. Since it cannot happen, there was a mandate that let us have at least one exam 2 months, 1 month after the final MEBS. So you give your degrees. Let any medical college and the vice chancellor, they want to give degrees. Okay, you give your degrees. Give your gold medals, 7 gold medals. But finally, let everyone but at the same platform when you have the entrance exam. So this was the idea. So let's move one step, and I would solicit your support for that. If it can be converted into a national final MBBS exam, nothing like it. But it is not easy. So let's do what is easy and what possibly can be done. And the internship part is very vital. So he does not have to read any theory. He has just passed his MBBS. In 4 weeks he gives, so he doesn't have to give any more worries. So he gets into the exam, finishes his theory. Now 1 year he is in the clinics. There is a skill set exam after 1 year. That is his internship. So he doesn't have to go to books. Nothing in the final clinical exam and would be from the books. So it is all the skill set. So you combine 50% of that and 50% of that, and he has a national merit list, no more exams. After this,
he is ranked, let's say 1 to 50,000 or so. Those who are not ranked, after 50,000, let's say there is another 5 lakhs more. They all would have at least 33%. If they get 33%, they are passed to practice. If he is less than 30%, let's say he gets 10% out of the exam, he can appear in 1 month again. Again in one month, so that he has a license to practice. So this was the basic. Now let's say the total number of seats today is 64,000. After 64,000, you have, let's say, another 5 lakhs. Where do they go? What is the benefit? So they appear in the UPSC exam, they appear in railways, they appear in... So the list from 64,000 when the medical college is finished is taken for all states, for all central, for all other jobs they can be taken in. So the whole idea is medical guys appear for one exam, at final MB it is all right, if not, immediately after final MB, then one for clinical, then no more exams. This is the whole idea that I would like to...
Thank you, sir. I will request...
So do you all agree? Please, those who agree, raise hands.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's give a big hand to Dr. K.K. Agarwal for his valuable contribution. And sir, may I request to have sir the memento, sir, on behalf of organization committees. Ladies and gentlemen, sorry for the interruption. We go ahead where we left. Now the next is coming on to the post-graduation training programs. So may I request Dr. Ashok Agarwal to address the needs of enhancing the ethical values and training, sir, of the experts medical fraternity, which you are looking forward to work in periphery as well as rural areas, sir.
Good morning to all of you. Thank you, Vice Marshal Raniyal. In fact, I'd like to draw your attention to the latest High Court observation yesterday, and it's quoted in the Times of India and many other newspapers in today's editions. It says that one of the main reason of the violence against the doctors in the hospitals, I'm sure some of you might have read this, is the shortage of the experts in our Delhi hospitals. Because the doctors are overworked, the patients are already anxious, they are waiting for a long time and they get irritated, and then there is an altercation, conflict, and some assaults take place. Now, if this is the situation in the Delhi hospitals, if this is the situation in the Delhi hospitals, imagine of an average district hospital. Leave aside the taluka hospitals, sub-district hospitals, or the 30-bedded community health centers, where we do not have the specialist that we are talking of, say the anesthetist, say the radiologist, or the critical care medicine experts, or the clinical cardiologist, the non-intervention cardiology expertise, the dialysis medicine, and quite a few others. So these are the key areas or key specialists which are missing from an average district hospital in the country. We have been talking in the morning, we had a very good panel discussion, that the Indian doctor is a brand. Now where is this brand when we talk of the 2/3 of the population in the country in an average district town? So we have to think out of the box. Ethical part I'll come little later, because a lot of discussion has been taking place on the ethical issues. But I'm at the moment talking of the availability of the common specialist in the country, because of which all the population, 2/3, bypasses the rural health facilities or the district hospital and land up in the either private hospitals or so-called medical college hospitals, where they pay through their nose and go into the debt. And on an average, it is now said that 25% of all the hospital admissions in the country, people go below poverty line because they are paying by selling their assets and all that. So we have to think out of the box. I'm very happy that today I'm sharing this forum with Dr. Sareen, Dr. Bipin Batra, who are the, you know, from two important regulatory bodies. I have been in IGNU, sir, for 17 years. And for the first time in this globally, we started programs through open and distance learning. Many of you are aware of the PG Diploma in Clinical Cardiology, a non-intervention cardiology program. Though we say IGNU is through open distance learning, but this was a full-time program which we started, and it was a runaway success. And today, you talk of the Lakshadweep, you talk of the Everest District Hospital. Many of these hospitals did not have a ICU, leave aside coronary care unit, have the ICUs, and the postgraduates from IGNU in PGDCC, postgraduate diploma in clinical cardiology, are manning these hospitals and are very successful. Similarly, the dialysis medicine, we developed a program, 1 year program, and this was 6 months hands-on skill, and the remaining was through the you know, online teaching, the contact programs and other things. We developed a program in family medicine called the postgraduate diploma in maternal and child health. We developed a program, rural surgery. You know, these are the things that out of the box, when I say that we have to, you know, think as a regulatory body that we should look after the needs of the people, those who are catering or being catered to at the peripheral hospitals. A rural surgery is a concept which in IGNU we developed, multi-skilling a surgeon so that he or she can do a life and limb saving surgery, whether it is a obstetric gynecology problem or emergency in orthopedics or a general surgery. That single person who is trained in a rural surgery can look after all these essential life and limb saving surgical procedures. So, you know, this is the issue that probably when Ranial, Air Vice Marshal Ryan, told me that the restructuring the postgraduate medical education, I would like to, I think, stop here, give this idea to the distinguished panel here as well as the audience to then go forward and we discuss a little more about it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. One of the panelists is with us is Dr. N.V. Parekh, sir. Sir, can you throw some light as well as copyrights and patents? What is happening is whosoever does a copyright and do a patency, sir, they are, but these are being confined only to few privileged. So can I take your advice so that which steps can be taken to expand the availability of knowledge far and wide, which can help develop contemporary healthcare system in the interest of large number of populations?
Good morning, everybody. And first of all, thank you for inviting me to this forum. I'll just tell you about the code of ethics, which is very short and sweet regarding the copyright and the patent act. Can we have? Yes. So what it says is, a physician may patent surgical instruments, appliances, medicines, or copyright application methods and procedures. However, it is very clear, however, it shall be unethical if the benefits of such patents or copyrights are not made available in situations where the interest of large population is involved. I think it is quite clear and self-explanatory that whatever research is done, whatever patents are made, whatever copyrights are done, it is all for the society. So you cannot restrict the benefits of any such things to the society at large.
Thank you, sir. I thought you were going to give us another slide. So now, since Dr. K.K. Agarwal has gone, sir, the next question goes to Dr. Krish Tyagi, sir. Sir, it is very common practice to promote a specific individual, what I'm talking about, the consultants, or a diagnostic center, or a healthcare organization, sir, in lieu of rebates and commissions, which is very unethical act or practices. What step do you advise as a leading healthcare administrator to curb such menace among our medical fraternities?
Hello? Yeah, these rebates and commission and the use of the tout, whether in the diagnostic or the nursing home or in the individual practice, of course it is unethical. And time and again at Delhi Medical Council we have put up an ad with the media, maybe the Delhi, ad in the Delhi Medical Association news bulletin or in the general media to apprise the practitioner about that, because it is the image of the medical profession at large, because people are going to the, say, lab asking, okay sir, what's the commission you are giving to the doctor, concerned doctor who has referred me to this lab. They know each and everything. For the MRI, every MRI there some amount is paid to the referring consultant. Every media knows it, public knows it, politician knows it, doctor of course we knows it. Various sting operation has been done in the labs, and of course then the Medical Council of India take, when the it took issues were take up in the Lok Sabha, then of course it was sent to the Medical Council of India, and since there are around 13 labs are there in the Delhi, in which their sting operation was made, and which was the case is pending with the Delhi Medical Council. Of course, we are investigating that case, but it gives a bad name to the profession and to the medical profession and the practitioner. And one thing about that internship issue, Dr. Sarin at the Medical Council, we're helping with the affairs, and we are very hopeful that, because at Delhi Medical Council, our office is at Maulana Azad Medical College, leave aside the medical college of the UP and Bihar, even the persons of the medical students of the Maulana Azad Medical College from a third year, they are not going to the wards. They are going to the PG Coaching Institute. During the internship, they never go to the wards. And one more information to share, we have got around, of course, some are Indian graduates and most of them are former graduate. They applied for the permanent registration with the internship completion certificate. Some persons had done the internship from, they say, RML Hospital or Gangaram Hospital for the 10 months or 8 months or so. Then the 2 months village posting they have done from the UP, and specifically some districts of the UP. And we have provided registration with the, to those students. Somehow we got the information that these students have not done the PhD posting from that particular institution in the UP. Then we got it confirmation for that particular institute whether these, it was regarding that 11 students only. And surprisingly, we got the information that those persons have not done the PhD posting from that place. Then of course we showcased, and they have provided us the document that internship completion certificate was issued by that so-called institution. Then showcased notice of institution, and then their medical registration has been cancelled. Medical Council of India and the state medical councils are being informed that these persons are using the forged certificate. Now they have gone to the High Court, and of course since the High Court the pending the case is in the coming Monday on 22nd. Of course, the High Court is sympathetic to us, the student. They have asking Delhi Medical Council to take a lenient view and provide them the register. But this is the story. Story means our students, medical students who are going to treat the patients tomorrow are not going to the hospital to see the patient. Skill is nil. Internship, during internship, they never give a IV injection. IV cannula, ask them to fix the IV cannula, they will not fit. How will they see the patient? Leave aside the communication skill and the other skill, they are not inclined to go to the ward. They are MCQ master. You ask the causes of the splenomegaly, they will set 1 to 15, say 1, 2, 3, 4, say, in the night itself, in the dream itself. But once you ask them to where they spleen, then they think over whether it is right or the left. It is an actual fact, and I am hopeful, and we medical profession and societies think that Dr. Sarin will take care of these kind of issues. And sir, we are
sir, Dr. Gresh, you just spoke about the punitive action as well as the legal actions which are available in society to check such a bad, you can say, component of our medical fraternity, sir. That should always be there. But what I am looking forward to, we have got so many associations. We have got Indian Medical Association at every district level, sir. Then we have got our own, every specialty has got their own association, sir. Can they not talk of these unethical practices which are happening among their own profession, sir? So can't they discuss, sir? That is what I am looking forward to from each, whether it's a radiology, whether it's a pathology, whether a hospital administration or anything, sir. When can't they discuss, sir? That is where I want that forum should be open and having a discussion. Your point, sir.
Yeah, Dr. K.K. Karwal, who is the Indian Medical Association president, and of course, in every state, there is state medical association and the local branches association. Technically and ethically, these medical associations talk about that if there is any mishappening or if there is any such kind of thing is but they are not taking actions against the doctors. Leave aside, a doctor said in Dwarka, caught red-handedly taking the PCP under the PCP and detect doing the sex determination, and he was the office bearer of Delhi Medical Association last year. And Delhi Medical Association has not terminated his membership, for which it doesn't matter anything for a person whether it is registered with the medical association or not. It is an NGO. Medical association means just an NGO. But our medical association are not taking action against the doctors which are inducted by that. So we should be proactive towards the black sheep. Of course, it is a 1% which are causing the bad name to the profession.
Sir, I hope it's the peer pressure which will finally bring this into it, sir. We have got among us from the FIKI, Dr. Shobha Mishra. Ma'am, I have got something to tell you before I ask a question. In 1993, a Joint National Committee on Prevention, Detection, Evaluation and Treatment of High Blood Pressure was conducted. And they concluded that diuretics and beta blockers are the most preferred choice of initial antihypertensive therapy. But what happened in the next 4 years was that the prescription of diuretics and beta blocker decreased by 50%. And instead of that, calcium channel blockers were promoted by the pharmaceutical companies, and which rose by more than 13%. At that time, possibly an inferior drug being prescribed instead of clinically recommended evidence-based medication. And secondly, moreover, it was discussed now, the medical students, interns, residents, as well as physicians, they all are subjected to barrage of advertising leading to physician industry connection, which is harmful for our system. So, ma'am, can I have your views on the freebies, rebates from pharmaceutical industry and the hidden agenda of promotion in the process of hosting various medical education programs? What corrective measure do you recommend, and what positive role a pharma industry can play to curb these practices?
Thank you, Dr. Ranyal. Good morning, everyone. I would like to thank Dr. Shakti Gupta for inviting me, and I'm really privileged to be seated in such eminent company. So just listening to the previous panel and this panel, what struck to my mind is the lack of ethical practices or corruption in our society is actually a reflection on the moral values and systemic deficiencies that we have in our society. And that is what translates into the various practices, whether it is in medicine or whether it is pharmaceuticals or medical technology or anything that is related to healthcare. Indian pharma industry is actually known worldwide for being able to provide cost-effective generic drugs. We have the distinction of being known as the pharmacy of the world, and that is something which we should take pride in. Having said that, we also know that almost 20% of the drug cost gets increased because of the incentivization that the pharma companies give to doctors or physicians for prescribing their drugs. This is something which is extremely avoidable, and the pharma industry has come to severe criticism because of this nature. And particularly when you know, we have more than 40% of our population which is below poverty line. Almost 39 million people annually are pushed down the poverty line because of healthcare expenses. And that being so, because almost 62% of our healthcare expenses are out of pocket. It is indeed a very, very serious concern. And it is not just particular to India, it is a worldwide concern. In 2009, MCI had come up with a code of ethical practices for the doctors, but it was not binding on pharmaceutical companies. In 2011, Department of Pharmaceutical actually came up with the Uniform Code for Pharmaceutical Marketing Practices, UCPMP, which was supposed to be a voluntary code of ethics to be adopted by the pharmaceutical companies, and which meant that no pharma company can give any kind of gifts, incentives to the doctors. No pharma company can actually pay for the travel and hospitality of any physician abroad in the name of conference, and so on and so forth. That somehow was not able to, it was not implemented, it was not adopted by the industry. But recently, the same UCPMP code has been revived. And in fact, FICCI has been involved with the Department of Pharmaceutical, along with other industry association bodies, Ministry of Commerce, etc., and Ministry of Health, to develop this code so that, and what it entails is that the code will be adopted voluntarily by the pharmaceutical companies. The CEO and the, or the MD will actually file its acceptance annually with industry association bodies, and here the industry association bodies have the role to play to see that the compliance is effective. So this is what I think is the need of the hour. What the pharma companies can do, and what the doctors, and I think what it ought also ought to be told to the medical student, is that we know that, you know, technological advancements in medical sciences is something which the doctors, physicians have to keep themselves updated with. And therefore, ongoing training programs, ongoing courses on the advancements is very, very essential. Technology platforms, digital education is something which Dr. Ashok Agarwal also mentioned, is something that can be leveraged for the continuing education of physicians. The pharma companies can do webinars where they can, you know, bring doctors, eminent doctors like Dr. Sareen, Dr. Puri, and others who can actually do webinars to talk about the new drugs, the new medical technologies which are there. And those webinars can be attended by the physicians as well as by the medical students. And one particular point I wanted to make over here was that most of the medical technology companies particularly say that when there is a new device which comes up or new equipment which comes up, only an online or digital course is not going to be enough for the doctor, because they have to physically be trained. So either they have to be trained within the country or taken abroad. So these are the things which one needs to keep in mind, and any kind of education or incentivization, any kind of education that is required should be done in an extremely transparent manner, so that there is no compromise as far as the technical expertise which is required to use a new drug or a new device is compromised. Thank you,
ma'am. So we are looking forward to good. We only blame the industry. We must look into our self also. But madam, these suggestions you have put forward to teach and to make people learn about whatsoever latest equipment or the medicines you are having. May I come on to now, sir, Dr. Vipin Batra, sir. Sir, the medical education and training plays a major role in inculcating ethical values and respecting human rights, sir, of patient, attendant, and the community as a whole, sir. But of late, it is observed that there is a clear violation of human rights by our medical fraternity, which leads to number of conflicts. May I seek your expert views on the corrective steps which may be included in the medical, nursing and the dental education training, sir?
Thank you, Vice Marshal Raniel, for posing this very important question. Now, human rights and medical ethics are two distinctive tracts which do come together. While human rights assume a legal validity and sanctity for enforcement, a large facet of medical ethics remains a benevolent act on part of the physician as part of his code of conduct too. Whether they choose to implement the mechanisms for enforcement of ethics remains very vague. There are certain areas where the medical ethics, the enforcement of medical ethics is there, but a large part of the medical ethics remains to the benevolence of the practitioners. Now, as far as the education part is concerned, it is very, our regulations both at the undergraduate as well as the postgraduate level and the curriculum systems make very vague references to the medical ethics as well as human rights. In fact, in the graduate medical regulation, there are just 5 references made. At 5 points, the word medical ethics comes in. And as part of the general educational paradigm, what is not assessed is not learnt or not even taught properly. So medical ethics is something which is not being assessed. It is not being imbibed in our assessment systems. And the consequential effect is seen that the students come totally unprepared when it comes to implementation of ethics. And in terms of its learning and implementation, which is the second part of your question, as far as the learning part is concerned, medical ethics is something which is more contextual. It can be applied in clinical settings. It cannot be transformed as a didactic transfer of knowledge from the consultants or the faculty to the students in one go, or we hand them over the booklet of etiquette regulations prescribed by the MCI or whatever literature is there to the students in one go to be imbibed by them. It doesn't happen like that. So the internship as well as the early formative years of residency are very, very vital timelines where this contextual application could be built in. And this is where much of the activity is right now happening. In fact, I'll share with you one very important development which has taken place in the country in the last 18 months. The UNESCO was very concerned about the poor implementation of bioethics globally, not just in developing countries, but globally. By the way, India today is world's second largest producer of medical graduates, next only to China, with 65,000 medical graduates being produced and 35,000 residency positions existing at the PG level. So cumulatively, we have around 100,000 points where we can reach out to the trainees per annum. And this is roughly 10% of our existing physician population, which is on the rolls of Indian Medical Register. Now, UNESCO launched a global chair in partnership with the University of Haifa, Israel. And the Haifa program, in turn, has established a large number of bioethics programs world over in partnership with individual medical institutions and universities. India has been one of the rising star as part of the UNESCO Haifa program, and as on date there are 140 programs which have been started in the last 18 months. The National Board has been glad to partner with the UNESCO Haifa program and launched a single direct vertical which will impact around 7,000 trainees every year and will reach out to 550 plus hospitals. Similarly, there are 130 medical colleges in the country which have adopted the writ of the UNESCO Haifa program. So all this is voluntary. And happening, there are regulatory changes which are proposed. The regulatory framework will continue to play at its own pace. But these milestones have really transformed the ecosystem. A lot of work is happening in this space, whether it is clinical case writing. In fact, last year, the UNESCO World Bioethics Day was celebrated as the confluence between human rights and bioethics. So I'm sure that outcomes from these programs will be seen not in distant future but in near and medium term future.
Thank you very much, sir. Yeah, please.
This is UNESCO Bioethics Courses 1. Actually, the initiative was taken by WHO way back in 2005 we already have a document, a module, which was started undergraduate teaching of ethics and psychosocial issues in undergraduate medical education. This was the initiative taken by many countries in CERO, and a curriculum was developed, tested. Many of the cases were constructed. In fact, AIIMS has one of the project where many of the cases, the contextual, you know, something Southeast Asia, many all of us have very similar issues using all the principles of ethics. So they were constructed, and this was through councils in 2008. This module was finalized. Through councils, it was disseminated. Now, many of the countries have actually adopted that, and it's already in this. And many of the school colleges in India also are. So there is something going on for the last 12 years, and there are many colleges. Actually, one of the things that we see in India is because we are so large, we have so many colleges. There's a lot of, we were talking about the India brand that we discussed in the last session, and Dr. Agarwal asking the same question, where does that brand go when it comes to our own populations? So therefore, there's a lot of variability. So it's not that colleges are not doing, there are a lot of colleges who are actually teaching ethics. Way back in St. John's, you know, 1978, they had a module which is already, you know, they've been teaching ethics as an undergraduate from late 70s or early 80s, I think. So there is already a lot happening, but it's very, very variable. That's the issue.
Thank you, ma'am. When you start from an undergraduate education to the internship to the postgraduate, or while the practicing or you are continuing medical education programs which are being conducted, the main thing, crux, comes onto the doctor-patient relationship. Now, two things I just want to say before I give it to Dr. Parekh. Number of relations of the patient come and disclose something about the patient to the doctor. Because doctor, usko mat batana ki maine aapko bataya hai. The other thing comes something like teenage patient coming for the abortion, ki parents ko nahi batana. The question is how to balance. So is it the only the confidentiality, or that's what where the doctor-patient relationship falls on us? May I request Dr. Parekh to throw some light, please.
Thank you, sir. I am representing the Ethics Committee of Medical Council of India here, and I have been shocked by the number of the complaints for violation of the codes of ethics that is coming up to the MCI as well as to the state medical councils. Now, we have the code of ethics in place. We have this UNESCO, HIFA, and so many things are there. But nothing is helping, it seems, because the number of violation of ethics cases are continuously increasing. So why it is happening? It happens because I think that Dr. Batra should be ethical. Dr. Tyagi should be ethical. But for me, it is okay to be little unethical. I know my limits. That is how it starts. So why do we need this 3-day conclave on ethics? Ethics is a matter of common sense. Even if you don't read the code of ethics, each of us knows what is ethics. We don't need to study ethics at all. It is inbuilt. So ethics has to come within. If each one of us decides that I'll be ethical, automatically the entire problem is going to get solved. And because this does not happen, it leads to a breach of trust. There is a breach of trust between the patient and the doctor. And once this trust breaks, then there are other associated problems. So somehow we need to restore the patient-doctor relationship to the ideal level. There is a thought that the engineers are not ethical, the lawyers are not ethical, the politicians are not ethical, businessmen are not ethical. Then why doctors should be ethical? We are also a part of the same society. Now the doctors have been given a privilege which even gods have not been given. Can explain it to you. A man comes with his woman to you. He readily gives the permission to you to undress the woman, and he thanks to you for that and pays to you for that. Now this is the privilege. Don't we need to have the highest ethical standards in our practice? I I was trying how to explain the ideal doctor-patient relationship. I came across a video which is based on an old Bollywood song. And I think if you listen to that video, probably we will all be very clear what is an ideal doctor-patient relationship. It is just a 3.5 minutes video, but I think it is worth a watch. It will answer all our queries on doctor-patient relationship. Can we have the video, please?
I happen to be the last speaker. There's very little time left. So I was inspired to sing, which I shall sing before you, which carries the essence of doctor-patient relationship, which we have to bear in mind. I have Dr. Parikh here, and he bears me out that Dr. Ambrose Paré, in the 16th century, he gave a great quotation, "I dress the wound, God healed the wound. I dress the wound, God healed the wound." So God there. And till today on wound healing, we know nothing except the fact that God heals the wound. So allow me to sing for you, and I'm sure you can join. Mariz means a patient. Mariz ki muskarahato pe ho nisar. Mariz ka dard mil sake to le udhar. Mariz ke vaaste ho tere dil mein pyar. Doctor isi ka naam hai. We doctors are expected to be well-dressed, but never too well-dressed, because it intimidates the patient. There is a conversation in New England of Medicine where a patient tells the doctor, "Doctor, I'm afraid of you because you are too well-dressed for me." So we are supposed to be voluntarily poor. Mana doctor dekhne mein fakir hai, phir bhi yaro dil ke wo ameer hai. Mana doctor dekhne mein fakir hai, phir bhi yaro dil ke wo ameer hai. Mite maris ke liye wo zindagi, kare maris ke liye wo bandagi. Kisi ko ho na ho hame hai tabar, doctor isi ka naam hai. A patient comes to us not by walking, not in car, not on cycle, but on a path of faith. A patient comes faith. Faith. Rishta hai maris ke etbar ka, zinda hai tabib se naam pyar ka. You know one thing I tell you. Somebody in distress, you look at the person as your own. And if love is dripping from your eyes, much of the patient's illness is likely to be mitigated. We must look at the patient. It's I who am suffering. It's I. It's incidentally. In fact, in Quran it is said that before a doctor goes to a patient, he must do thank the God that but for your mathematics, I could be there and the patient could be here. Please remember. Rishta hai maris ke etbar ka, zinda hai tabib se naam pyar ka, ke mar ke bhi maris ko yaad aayenge, maris ki aansuon mein muskuraayenge, kahega har maris maris se baar baar, doctor isi ka naam hai.
Thank you, Dr. Parikh. Before we come to the end, I will request Dr. Sivsarin, please.
It's a very moving video, which I couldn't see, but I could feel. There are three parts of our medical profession. More important, patient, student, and teacher. I will discuss some parts, what are needed, because the session was on medical education. So the first concept is pay the man his worth. Is the medical teacher being paid well? Is he being designated well? Say in a state medical college, he remains a lecturer for 15 years. He never gets to, or he remains an assistant professor. He never gets to an associate. While if you are in Central Health Service, he will become a professor even in 6 years. How do you overcome this inequality in medical education? Because you don't have teachers. So what we did and propose that if you finish X number of years as an experience, even if there is no post available, he should be given a designation. And that's how ESIs, Safdarjung, all these hospitals got consultants into faculty position. But states haven't, and I think we should make effort for that, that all states. This was helped actually to somewhat by Dr. Gupta, who was in the equivalence committee at that time with Medical Council with us. The second issue was of every undergraduate wants to do post-graduation. So PG must be equal to UG, but we don't have teachers. So this was one attempt, and DNB has helped to some extent, but still there are lacunae. So the next step was that every professor gets 3 post-graduate students in broad specialties and hopefully for super specialties. So that would, if it comes, you will have with the same infrastructure, like a PhD student can have, I mean, a PhD guide can have 8 students, so you can have this. So this was the next major change. The third was an issue of MD-MS thesis. Are they worthwhile? And I think we need to debate it at one bigger forum. So the whole idea was somebody has a diploma of 2 years plus does 1 year extra, he is MD-MS. Otherwise, that diploma word was converted into an M.Med, he is a Master of Medicine, but in gynecology, he is Master of Medicine and ophthalmology. So he does 2 years, he has no academic position, but if he does 1 more year of thesis or research, then he would be able to become a MD-MS and he goes into the academic line. While an M.Med of 2 years, that is your diploma holder, can also teach undergraduates at a district level. So how to overcome these was, fourth part was about the CME programs, you know, those who have been treated, and I think IMA has taken a lead in saying that CMEs should not be funded by pharma. And this is a huge debate which we should openly discuss another day, that how do you fund continuing medical education? And I think you have 8 lakh doctors, you need to educate them. Also, so what we do at ILBS, we are connected to 52 colleges. We teach them hepatology 1 year course without any charge. Everyone can do that, but there is no substitute to a CME, and how do you fund CMEs? Now, for example, you have a private doctor, he is teaching somewhere else, let's say, and he goes versus a medical doctor who is teaching in an institute. He has a limited salary of 1 lakh, 1.2 lakhs, but the other person gets 10 lakhs. So the issue in this is, if I go and teach, can I earn money? Say I go and give a talk in a medical, you know, conference. I can say, I will charge 20,000 rupees per lecture for 1 hour. Is it ethical or not? So we set up a committee long back with Mr. Narayan Murthy, as how to pay the doctors their worth. And this was clearly debated. You put on your website, I will charge this much money for this time. My conflicts of interest are Sun Pharma, Ranbaxy, Cipla, but these are my conflicts. So we need to pay our doctors without adding money onto the government or exchequer. And we need to find way ethically to stabilize our medical education, reimbursement or, you know, remuneration to doctors, fixed pay versus variable pay. So these were some for the doctors. So how do you pay the doctors their worth? The second part is coming to the students. Now we teach jurisprudence for 1 year or so, but that jurisprudence is only medico-legal cases. It does not include anything in ethics. It does not include any legal knowledge. If we all think about changing the curriculum, I think it could be an essential fulcrum of that 1 year course, you teach ethics, you teach legal issues, you teach medical legal cases. Everyone just abandons that jurisprudence, but that could become a core, and it comes at the mid-level of your learning before you go further. Now coming to one more area, which are two more areas. One is we never wear white coats, and I am reminded when I joined All India Institute, it was day one, and Lala, the famous R.P. Agarwal, he was Dr. Agarwal was taking rounds. There were 8 residents in casualty, 6 were in aprons, 2 were not in aprons. They were suspended on the spot and sacked. There was no question asked, he suspended and sacked them. So it was a written rule, at least at that time, that you have to wear aprons. Why? I do not know. I did not know at that time, but as I grew up, I realized if you wear a white coat, you realize, yes, you are doing something and you are bound by some rules. How do you assess publications? It comes to teachers. The number of retractions has increased and plagiarism. And I think the medical education must include this as another area where we are clear that plagiarism is not done. I have two or more things with Dr. Parikh. I am very assured. In 2010, there was no SOP for an ethics committee in MCI. You know how the ethics committee should function as for its own working. So the first guidelines were developed in 2010 as the guidelines of running. I'm sure they have been updated, but how all ethical committees should look into should also be. And I can say it now because the oversight committee where we were working, the tenure is over for 1 year. So I am free to say this because we finished 3 days ago, that there is a need for revamping how ethics committees should run and what should come to the state, what should come to the center. And there is a new assessor's guide for assessing medical colleges. My last important message is to Dr. Shakti, I really salute you for what you have, you know, initiated, brought back, and I think there should be many such more activities, and I feel that it should be recorded that such activities help us look into ourselves and do introspection, eternal vigilance and internal vigilance. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sareen. Just to conclude, I have to come onto the rostrum. Just to conclude, can I flash my slide, please?
Dr. Shakti Gupta, thanks a lot, sir. Am I audible? Thanks a lot, sir, for giving me such panelists with us. My job was very simple. I just spoke to them, and remaining talking was done by them. Thank you. Each and every one of you. Just to conclude, can I have next slide, please? I will just like to tell you the story of a boy and his bicycle. I will request panelists to just turn their neck for a few seconds. When the toddler, as an infant, the child is scared of the bicycle. So just because he is unconscious and incompetent. Then gradually when the boy grows, he becomes conscious, he is not scared of the bicycle, but he is incompetent. He requires a sport. So sport from whom? From our teachers, from our guide, who can hold us so that we can ride the bicycle. As we grow in our profession, we become conscious as well as competent. So the boy is independent to ride the bicycle of his own. But what we are looking forward to, we come to the unconscious and competent level. All our ethics, values which have been taught to us in the last 3 days should be back of our mind. We should be working on unconscious level for our ethics, whether from the day one, and we should be doing the competent. That's where the boy rides a bicycle with the girlfriend, not bothered how to ride the bicycle. So where we are, what I think we are at conscious and incompetent level, and what I want is we should come on to the unconscious and competent level. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
That was an interesting session.
This was to tell them how exactly to get a bike and go ahead. We will have at least one or two questions because education is always, and I always like forward my panelists to answer. Yeah, please. One by one. On mic, please.
Hello. This is Dr. Saurabh. And my address will be to Dr. Girish sir in particular and all to all the eminent panelists who are in the policy making. Sir, it was rightly pointed out that the budding graduates and interns, they are becoming MCQ masters and they are having very little technical or the clinical skills. But sir, few facts, though a bit randomly written, I would like to point it out that our profession is the one which is having the longest study duration. And second thing, the next thing is that with the although the number of postgraduate seats have been increased, but there is a disparity in the stipend. There is a disparity in the post graduation the job bonds with the states. There is a disparity in this fee structure and many things, and there is growing amount of litigation every year. So even the person who has secured a good rank, he is not sure about what seat he is going to get finally. And till the time he joins the medical college, he's totally confused or he's not sure what actually is going to happen to him. The next thing which I would like to point in particular to the policymakers in particular, sir, recently the Honorable Prime Minister has raised the retirement age of doctors to 65. And still the entry age in UPSC CMS exam, it is still 33 or 35. We should also increase the job opportunities for the growing, the budding graduates and the medical professional, so that the person who has cleared his MBBS exam and he's looking out for post-graduation, he should not be left in lurch in between. If we compare the professionals who are like engineers and other people, they are getting a good package and still we have to thrive on stipends. So this, and one thing more, if a person who has completed his MBBS and he has, although he has not secured his post-graduation seat, although he has acquired some of the clinical skills, but even in the private sectors or say in the government sectors, whatever be the job openings are there for medical professionals, they are actually asking for an MCQ exam. So when everything is all MCQ based, then why not he should focus his attention on the MCQs.
Yours were all the administrative questions, and I will request few to be answered, please.
Hello. Yeah, you rightly said that regarding that, of course, duration is long. Everybody knows about it. A person, same batchmate, say medical student and the engineering student. Engineering students after the 4 year get a good package, and our after say 4.5 years the internship person get a just a meager salary. And leave aside that person who has we have seen that most of the medical students who are coming to Delhi for doing the internship, I am telling you the exploitation. They are doing the internship at different places, but they are not being paid. I have raised this point to the corporation also, because once I came to know, one person in the corporation, even the doing the internship, they have to pay the about, 12,000 to 18,000 for doing the internship, and they are not being paid. When they are doing the job, why the authorities are not paid them? Because if the same person is doing the internship at the Karnataka, he should have got the remuneration there. But coming to Delhi, he is not being paid. They are working here. Why not the government or the Medical Council of India should issue the directions to the different institutions who are providing the internship that these children should be paid? Because at some of the students came to for the registration, they just keep whipping. That for asking at this stage also, they are asking their parents to pay them for the petrol charges also, for the tea charges or the coffee charges, or if they want to go to the movie, they have to ask their parents to pay them. And their counter batchmate from the engineering are going for the five-star hotels or so for, say, taking a tea. So these kind of issues, medical association as well as the government, as well as the Medical Council of India should direct the institutions. They should not be exploited, medical students or the internship.
Thank you. I'd like to address two of your very important concerns. One is there has been absolute increase in the number of postgraduate opportunities, and the growth has been exponential thanks to the initiatives taken by the Oversight Committee, the Medical Council of India, the Government of India, in fact, all the medical institutions, state governments, which have responded to the call. Right now, the gap between undergraduate and postgraduate positions grossly is 1:2. Although from a student perspective, the gap is much more wider, and the reasons for that are not difficult to guess. One is the increasing granularity of seats, the way our seats are spread across various vertical silos. Second is our candidates today, they simply want to take up certain disciplines. There are just 9 or 10 disciplines where the rat race is there. For the remaining 42 disciplines, there are very few takers, and the reality hits them when they get their scorecards. So I think over a period of time, things will stabilize. A large part of growth in this space has happened only in the last 3 years, and a large number of regulatory changes have also come up in the last 3 years, and the results for that are just now beginning to percolate. The second issue which you raised about the MCQ-based assessment, I think this definitely has a cascading impact, a reverse cascading impact on the way our medical graduates and postgraduates today see medical education. The NEET super speciality will drive the MD programs, MD-MS programs, and the NEET PG will drive the MBBS program, and the NEET UG will drive the schooling or the 10th or the 12th standard schooling of the children. But what is happening today is beginning from MCQs, which were essentially rote learning or targeting only a memory recall, there has been a gradual shift towards the other side of the spectrum, and a large fraction of the MCQs today are being focusing on analytical skills and higher cognitive domains. We cannot translate this overnight and create a paper, because it is an eligibility test also. If we were to undertake a right-sided shift in the difficulty index of the question paper, we'll end up with a situation that not even 50% of all the candidates who are writing the exam would be able to qualify the exam. So we have to balance the difficulty index in a manner, and this will be an incremental and gradual step of shifting to the higher cognitive domains. In fact, All India Institute of Exam Medical Sciences is introducing 35% to 40% of their MCQs which are in the higher cognitive domain. For the NEET examinations, it is around 20%. So efforts are ongoing from the policymakers to address this issue. Thank you.
Two brief points. The Committee for Equivalence had recommended that if you have 4 years for the IT people or engineering people, but 5 years for medical, then they study another 3 years. So your term is like 9 years. So the UPSC should take care of every year of education. So somebody comes at 5 years of education, of a specialized professional education, he gets this level. If an MD guy goes with 3 years more of teaching, so he's 8 or 9 years, or MS guys, he should get 3 promotions from beginning. This was strongly recommended 2011, has not been implemented. If you all voice, this should become implemented. If there is an MCH, he has done 12 years, he gets 6 increments when he joins his jobs. So that is the first recommendation which we made, because we understand. The second part, you said that residents are not paid similarly at different places. Why can't there be OROP? One rank, one pay for medical professions. If everybody thinks that this is a problem, and I think personally, in my individual capacity, this is a problem. So I think, why not people paid equally when they do job equally well?
Sir,
one thing to add. The Medical Council of India has already made a rule, and it has already informed each and every institute that whether it is in the private sector or any sector, the amount of stipend to be paid to the resident will be at par with the respective state government. So if it is not implemented anywhere, you have to file a complaint with the details. I also want to just draw your attention to the package. See, if you are really interested in a package, probably you are in the wrong field. We need to understand that. You will never be able to compare your income to the top industrialists or top businessmen or some other professions. And the number of the seats you said about UGPG is basically, it is decided by the need of the nation. If this country needs more UG students, more MBBS doctors, then the seats would be there accordingly. If we need more of specialists, then the seats would go accordingly. No, it is basically depending on the need of the society.
I know there are so many questions, but I hope organizers are gunning at us. I will request all of you to question the panelist during the break after this over a cup of tea. Over the organizer, please.
Thank you, sir. We would like to conclude this session with the felicitation of the panelists.
I would like to invite Dr. Shiv Sarin, sir, to kindly felicitate Dr. Bipin Batra, sir.
Professor Rita Sood.
Dr. Girish Tyagi, sir.
Ms. Shobha, ma'am.
Dr. Nilesh Bhai V. Parekh, sir.
Dr. Ashok Kumar Agarwal, sir.
Dr. R. K. Raniel, sir.
I would now request Dr. Shakti Gupta, sir, to kindly felicitate the chairperson of this session, Dr. Shiv Sarin.
Group photo.